Happy Sabbath. This is a wonderful morning. And this morning, the Sabbath school lesson is about covenant, right? I'm always confused whenever I read about what's the difference between Old and New Covenant and so on. And it's tough for me to understand. I read about this again. Again, I'm sort of confused. And now, I have a very simple understanding on covenant. What is covenant after all? It is God's what? God's will. What God wants to do for us. That's covenant. It's so simple. Okay, yeah. God's covenant is, you don't have to know the Greek, right? Diadeke or whatever, okay. God's covenant means it is His will for us.
Amen.
Simple.
Amen.
There's something He wants to do for us. In a way, it is what? It is His promise. Even before we promised anything for Him. Okay? So it is God's promise. It is God's will. And there's something He wants to do for us. That's covenant. Okay. And Ten Commandments and all the Moses' law was His covenant. You know? Yeah. His covenant. Okay. That's what He is expressing. What He wants to do for us, right? You know, what is then old and new? There's no difference whatsoever. The reason why we have the new covenant is because we misunderstood God's covenant at the beginning. That's why. The God's people totally misunderstood God's will. So that's why God had to clarify His will for us again. That's who? Jesus Christ. See? Yeah. There's no two different covenant, old and new. You know? It's the same covenant. But unfortunately, the people who are supposed to receive God's will did not get it. Instead, they totally what? Misunderstood. So God has to what? Has to give, to tell them again, to show them again what He is really going to do. I think in terms of solving, the understanding the difference between these two covenants, Old and New Covenant, is so summed up simply by Ellen White. You know, I don't know whether she knew that she was summing that up, but when she said this, you know, I really believe Ellen White is really an inspired prophet of God. Okay. One of the reasons is this. This is one of the most powerful reasons for me that I know she is prophet. Is that Ellen White said, all God's command is promises. Yes, yes, promises. Okay. And at the beginning, I didn't know what she was talking about. Because when you open the Old Testament, there's a bunch of what? Command, do this, don't do this, yes, you shall do this, you shall not do this. All commands. Why she says it's a promise? Because she was inspired by something, right? Why she says that? See? When God promised to His people, to Jews, Jews accepted, received that promise as what? As command. That was the problem. You know, that's why all the Jews said what? We will what? We will do it. Yes, we will do it. We will do whatever you command us to do. So please, you know, we will do. We will do. Why? Because Jews misunderstood God's promise as what? As a command. Okay? Can you tell me, is there anyone here can tell me why God's command is a promise? Anybody? Why God's command is a promise? Okay. Actually, that's all. Lena is right. Because whatever he commands, we can't do anything without him. Amen. Right? Amen. So he has to do for us. That's why when he commands, it is a promise, isn't it? Amen. But all the Jews thought, whatever he commands, they could do it. That's why their answer was what? We will do it. See? It was total misunderstanding. Yeah. And what is your name?
Huh?
Tychus. Tychus? Okay, Tychus. How old are you?
13.
13. Okay. I found Tychus. He's only 13 years old. But unfortunately, he's an orphan. I know you're not, right? Let's pretend you are. Okay. He's an orphan. But I look at the Tychus, I spoke to him, and I found there's what? He has good potential. But he has no parents, no money. And I'm wealthy. I am a doctor. And so I liked him. I loved him. So I told Tychus, Tychus, I command you to be a doctor. How can Tychus be a doctor? See? Right? He cannot become doctor by himself, right? Is Dr. Sangli has to provide what? Money and everything for him to become a doctor. So when Sangli loved Tychus, and I said, Tychus, I want you to be a doctor. Means what? I promise you to make you a doctor, right? See? When you are in loving relationship, the command is what? Promise. See? Don't you want to have that kind of marriage? Yes. Yes. Whatever command, your husband command means what? Your husband will do it for you. Yeah? Isn't that wonderful marriage, right? Lori, I want you to have a diamond ring. Right. See, that means what? I'll buy one for you, right? Yeah. You know, this is relationship between me and God, right? So that's why all these commandments, Ten Commandments, is not a command. It is what? Promise. But unfortunately, God's people perceived as if it is what? Command. That what they have to obey. See? Yeah. So how much we are so what? So misunderstanding the word obedience. We will obey. You know. The true obedience is not that we do what God commands. What is now true obedience? We take the true obedience really means we take God's command as what? His promise. Then it is obedience. See? Yeah. Then it is true obedience. See? So we have all these word, the vocabularies in the Bible upside down. See? Command is command. Obedience is obedience at our level. Right? So God is simply commanding us, you know, and we are supposed to what? Obey. So this kind of wrong relationship was established by misunderstanding of the God's people to his old covenant. See? Yeah. That's why Jesus has to come down and what? Promise it again. See? Promise it again. You know. It was the same thing. Same thing Jesus is re-clarifying. That's it. See? I don't know why we're so comparing and so on, so on, you know, doing that. I just can't understand that. Okay? It's a re-clarification, that's all. See? Making it more simple, isn't it? Yeah. So, you know, all the covenant you knew, see, when everybody is looking at the cross, Jesus is now revealing his new covenant. That means what? All I meant to you by old covenant is what? This. Right? All the old covenant, you were so confused and you'll be so arguing about, the answer is what? Answer is this. Look at my blood. See? That's what I meant to you, my children. See? So he simplified it and he re-clarified it. Isn't that simple, right? And then, you know, why there's old and new, right? There's no reason actually should be there's two different covenants. There's not two different covenants. It's the same thing, but unfortunately God's people misunderstood it was the same thing. And that's why I'm so happy with Ellen White, because she is the really the one who completely so simplified that I haven't seen anyone saying that yet. You know, all the command of God is promise. See, what a beautiful statement. That just gave me peace of mind. You know. Wow. So, Tychus, you are going to be doctor, okay? Then Tychus says, thank you. Instead of what? I'll try. Yeah, that's right. You got it right? Yeah. So there are so many Christians saying, Herbert, you be a minister. Then Herbert says, I will try. Yeah. Then Herbert says, I don't think I can. Herbert didn't know it was what? Promise. You know why Herbert misunderstood that? Because someone who commanded him was not really promising. He was what? Commanding. That's why people get scared. You know? So, I hope Tychus says what? Oh, thank you, Dr. Sammy, thank you. When I said what? You're going to have to be a doctor, right? Instead, Tycho saying, I don't know, how can I be? Well, you know, medical school is expensive. I don't think I'm smart enough. If you command me, I'll try. God is not expecting that kind of understanding. That's total misunderstanding. See? When God commands, it means what? He is going to give you a full support. And if you don't make it, God will what? If you don't make it, God will wait for you. God will wait. And God is long-suffering God, right? God endures. Yeah. Isn't that wonderful? in this kind of God, the real ultimate sanctification is possible. Even though you're not ultimately sanctified, God still what? Embraces you. You are my child. Okay. Yeah. So, it's so simple, right? So I don't want you to be confused anymore about what? Old and new covenant. There's nothing is old or new. Okay? It is God's will, period.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah. God's will, period. God's will for sinners. He loves sinners. And he's determined to do his will. That is his promise. I am determined. You know? Tychus, do you know how much I love you? I love you like crazy. And I want you to take my office, okay? I want you to take all my patients. And I want you to be a doctor. Tychus, okay? And Tychus has to say what? Yay! Thank you, Dr. Lee. You know. He'll have what? Peace of mind, right? Now he will study good, right? Without having any what? Any worry, anything. So even though he failed, you know, even though he failed the first year, right? He'll come back to me, Dr. Sangni, I didn't make first year. I failed. Dr. Sangni says, Tychus, don't worry, I will make you a doctor. And Tychus would say what? Yes, thank you. What a relationship, right? What a relationship. We have that relationship with God. You know? Amen, right? Yes, this is wonderful. Okay. Like a Ten Commandments, like a thou shalt not murder, thou shalt not commit adultery, you know, thou shalt not steal. Okay. Is this command? Hmm? What promise? Now I explained everything. Now you have the answer. It's your turn. Okay. You seem to be very happy to listen to me, and let me now ask you. It's your turn. Okay. So why it is promise?
Because he promises, I will give you intimacy in all of your relationships, and I promise.
Okay. Don't get that complex. Okay. Yeah. Okay. And. Wait a second. When he say, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, why it is a promise? What kind of promise is that?
His will. His promise is
going
to give you the strength to do that.
Strength to do commit adultery?
That his character
will
not be revealed in our lives.
Yeah.
Well,
become very theological, okay. Yes. Be simple.
I know you will, but I will believe you.
Okay, we're coming a little closer, yeah.
He has the power, we don't.
Uh-huh. You know, it is impossible for us not to commit adultery. Well, some of you say, I never did. Really? Really? According to Jesus, we're all what?
Adulterers.
See? We all are. When you look at what? Someone. Wow. You commit adultery already, right? Yeah. Because he's not your husband. She's not your wife. You commit adultery. Yeah. Right? So it's impossible. Impossible for me. It is just like it is impossible for Tychus to become a doctor, right? Because he's an orphan. Yeah. Nobody can support him. So, same thing. Then what is it? Just apply the Tycho's principle. You know, when I realize I'm an adulterer, right? You know, 10th commandment, thou shalt not covet, right? Don't we covet? You know, yeah. And it is impossible not to covet. You know. When someone else has a beautiful wife is so good to him, you know. Oh, I wish my wife is like that. You sinned, right? Yeah. You sinned. How often all the wives says, I wish my husband is like that. See? Yeah. See, we are in sin. So when you know you are impossible sinner, then commandment is what? Is revealing to you as a promise. If you don't think you're a sinner, well, I never commit adultery. I'm keeping my commandment pretty well. Then you never know that's a promise. It is to you, it's all command. Okay. When you know, see, you are also adulterer. See. Like, when my ex-wife committed adultery, okay, and I felt like a condemning, how can you do, you know, that as a Christian, as a Christian? But then God spoke to me, saying, Lee, that's not much different between you and your wife, see? Maybe you have done much more. Then I said, you're right. Then, what does it mean? Thou shalt not commit adultery. Turn it around, please. That's right. I will help you. I will help you to become a person that you will not, what? Commit adultery, because you cannot be like that by yourself. Right? Praise the Lord. See? So if you know me better and better, if you come closer to me, you will not covet anything. Right? You will not covet anything. See, when you come closer to Jesus, you have the what? Best thing. Why should you, covet anything, right? Yeah. You know, before I became a Christian, I was so covetous of Mercedes Benz. When I was in Michigan in a medical residency in Wayne State University, in Michigan, there was all American cars, you know. The best car in Michigan was, at that time, it was a Cadillac. So whenever I saw Cadillac, wow. You know, especially Cadillac Eldorado, right? Two-door Eldorado, wow. I wish I could have. Then, to do the allergy immunology fellowship, I moved to California. Wow. There's a strange looking cars, you know, which I haven't seen any time before. What's that? They say, Mercedes. What's that? That's a BMW. I never heard about that, you know. What's that? That's a Porsche. How much? $40,000. $50,000. Wow. And then I begin to covet that, you know. Oh, I wish. And I covered Mercedes, you know, so much. So whenever somebody drive by Mercedes Benz, it was so stressful. When you covered, it's so much stress, you know, there. And then I felt, am I going to be able to drive that car before my death? Really? And I felt, if I don't make that car, if I don't, you know, end up buying that car, and I own that car, I felt like I wouldn't be able to die with eyes closed. Really, I felt that way, because my, you know, how lucky they are, you know, to be able to drive Mercedes in their lifetime. Boy, so it was so stressful. Finally, I opened up my practice. It was shockingly going well, you know. Boy, patients just, you know, coming in and in, and I could project my income just, you know. So my my income at that time was what? It was 1982, or 21 years ago. You know how much? Actually, I opened my office in 1976. So in 76, late 70s money, I was making almost $700,000 a year. You know, today's money, it's what? About $1 million. You're probably wondering, how can a doctor make that much money? You know, I had so many patients. I'm an allergy specialist, okay? Allergy specialist, if you have a patient, you can make money. You know how? You don't have to work that hard, you know? Because when you have like 1,000 patients, right? And they never go away. They belong to you. They can never go away. Why? They have to come to your office, have an allergy shot every week. Many of them have to come, almost 30% have to come twice a week, okay? Each visit, it is what, $10, right? I don't have to see them, okay? Can you imagine in one day, 300 people receive the shot, right? It's what, $3,000 in one day without for you doing anything. That's why $700,000, $1 million is possible, because then, you know, patient goes, you know, become more and more. Let's say you have a 2,000 patient. Then one day you have what? You have 500 people coming. In the meantime, you have new patients, new consultation, then hospitalization and so on. Boy, you don't have to work that hard to make $1 million. So I recommend you to change your specialty. Really, this, once you become a popular allergist, it is amazing, because it's so easy. But anyway, so I could easily figure out it is possible after 6 months of my practice, I know I could handle Mercedes, see? Yeah. Lori's husband is orthodontist, okay. You know what? Poor dentist, they have to see each patient, right? But I don't have to. Allergist, They have to work on each, every single one who come into the office. See? That's why they're constantly at work. But allergist, you know, if I don't have any new patient, I can sit there in my office and say, oh, the money keep on pouring in. And I can go to golf and money keep on pouring. Right. Isn't that nice? You didn't know that, right? So if you have a son, make him allergist. And you know, I felt, wow, money is no problem, you know? What a good feeling. I always had the problem with the money, but then suddenly, money became no problem. I want to buy, I could buy anything I want to buy. What a freedom, you know. It was so good. Then suddenly, I begin to feel fear. You know, this is so good. What if I die? What if I found I have a cancer tomorrow? Then what is going to do? What is going to happen to this such a good one situation I have? You know, I begin to be fearful. At that time, I didn't know God. But when I found God, right? You know what? It was definitely better than Mercedes. Really, really. So today, if Mercedes passed by, I don't hate Mercedes. I still love Mercedes. But you know what? I don't have to have one to be happy. Amen. That's the joy, you know? I said, wow, nice Mercedes, huh? Good. But you know, immediately I feel what? I wish you have Jesus too, you know, with Mercedes. I like to have a Jesus with Mercedes. Okay? To be honest with you, yeah. But I cannot make that much money to have Mercedes now. See? So I'm happy with the Toyota, you know. Toyota Sienna, you know. Yeah. The Sienna was best for me because I could, you know, have somebody else in the car, right? Yeah. Other people. So we have a little minivan Sienna. Very nice car, very nice. So, it is because I don't have to try so hard not to be covetous, right? So indeed, it was Ten Commandment, thou shalt not covet Mercedes, right? Thou shalt not covet Mercedes. Was fulfilled. His promise was what? Fulfilled. Because He came into me and He made me a person not to be covetous for Mercedes anymore. He fulfilled His what? His promise by His command. He did according to His command. Wow. See, this is joy of being a Christian. See? Yeah. Real joy. And so, you know, I wish I had more money, really. To have a lot of money and a good Christian, that's the best. Okay? I don't deny that. You know, but if I have a money now, a lot of money, I don't have many places to spend. You know? Well, if I have a lot of money, I like to build a nice what? New Start Center in Georgia, where I am. nice weather and beautiful area. But okay, let's forget about the New Start Center. Okay, but then I have a lot of money. I couldn't spend that. You know, where can I spend? And the only thing I like to spend. The money, if I have a lot right now, is, do you know what? Do you know what it is? Since I am flying so much, I like to be in business class at least. Oh, it's so comfortable, you know? Well, first class, no, not yet, you know, but at least business class, because all my friends are the first class, you know, because they're all what? Chairman of this and, you know, president of that and so on and so on. And I'm a president, but not that kind of president, you know. And at least it was so covetous of what? Business class. But you know what? It is so interesting. When I wasn't a Christian and I fly, I look at business class is way forward, right? And sometimes curtain opens, you can see business class. You know? Wow. I wish I could be there. But today, most time I'm in economy, okay? But sometimes I can get onto business class because I have lots of mileage, you know. So when mileage is enough accumulated, then I can upgrade, you know. So sometimes I get in. It's nice, you know. It's really nice. But I have peace of mind if I look at the business class today from economic class. Yeah, that's good. But you know what? No, I'd rather have a Jesus in economic class and in business class without Jesus, right? See, that solves all the stress problem, really. Yeah. It's a wonderful feeling, you know. Because I know how much I was covetous. I know how much I was so frustrated that I can't be at that business class, you know. But not anymore, you know. And also, I'm on my way to heaven, you know, which is a special class, right? Yeah. Unbelievable class. So no problem, you know. So it's, you know, Christianity has to be really real in your every moment of life. Really real. Okay, let me open Bible, Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 10. Okay, look at Daniel chapter 10, verse 18. Now, verse 19. And this is the scene Daniel was receiving revelation, okay? It was a revelation of what kind of revelation? What he was being shown? You don't know? Daniel is being shown horrible persecution. For how long? 1,260 days, yes. The God's people will be so persecuted, right? And Daniel saw that even beforehand, and he passed out. He was totally pooped. He was so scared. And how can that be? You know, and he almost lost his mind, you know. He just collapsed, okay. There's no strength, no energy, okay. Verse 19, and he said, who is he? Okay, let's start with verse 18. Then again, the one having the likeness of man touched me and strengthened me, and he said, O man greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be to you. And what? Be what? Be strong. Isn't it command, right? Jesus is commanding Daniel to be what? Strong. Be strong. Can Daniel become strong? No, impossible. Daniel is pooped. Then Jesus came to say, Daniel, be strong. Stand up. No, can he stand up? He can't. Impossible for him. Okay, now let's look at it. Be strong. So when he spoke to me, that means what? When he commanded me to be strong, right? When he spoke to me, I was what? Strengthened. See? So right here, according to the Bible, God's command, be strong, means what? I will strengthen you. Isn't it? Yeah. That's right. So clear to me. See. I don't know whether Ellen White saw this or not, but after I read Ellen White, I was trying to look for this kind of thing. Then one day, wow, like Herbert, you know. Yes, wow. I found this. Wow. Yes. O man be, O man greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be to you. Be strong. Yes, be strong. Exclamation mark. So when he spoke to me, I was strengthened. Praise the Lord, right? Yes. The one who spoke to Daniel, commanded Daniel to be strong, strengthened him. Daniel has nothing to do with it, right? Daniel simply what? Daniel simply understood his command as what? Promise. So for Daniel, the old covenant and new covenant, was it different? No, it's same thing. But other than Daniel, almost all other Jews, to them, command was command, unfortunately. Even today, so many God's people think command is command. And they are trying to what? Trying to fulfill so-called obey so hard. And then they're frustrated, disappointed, become hopeless. See? Those who doesn't get hopeless become indifferent. And many of us, well, he's like that, I'm like that. So we're all saying, we all go to heaven this way. That people, even today, don't know the truth yet. See? Yeah. And so I want to summarize here. I want to finish up. Okay. Don't argue about what's old covenant and new covenant. I think that's the most silly thing to do. Okay. It's a wasting of time. All you have to know, all we have to know is what? What God really meant. If we really know what God really meant by commands, commandments in Old Testament is promise, then now we know New Covenant too, right? It is the same. Wonderful. It's so simple. So this morning, I want to really clarify to you third time, right? God gave first covenant, which we call Old Covenant, we misunderstood. Now God gave second covenant, we misunderstood. Then God sent Ellen White. She said what? All command is a promise. She clarified again. We still what? Misunderstand. And here, this morning, let us all together be re-clarified. Okay. May God bless you with wonderful covenants of God. Amen. Amen.